So I'm curious, for all of my pre-PAs out there, have you guys actually looked at the current PA programs and narrowed it down to your top five that you plan on applying to yet? Have we? My name is Reese, the Psych PA, and this is my platform where I talk about medicine, lifestyle, and travel. Today we're going to be discussing how can you narrow down the search for your dream program. Do you know what your expectations are out of your dream PA program? Do you know the things that you want to be able to get besides your license and how the curriculum flows and everything like that out of your PA program? You know what you want out of your dream PA program. If not, that's okay. Let me just give you five things to keep in mind when considering a PA program. Before someone says anything, this is just my top five things that I kept in mind when I was researching and looking for PA programs to apply to. So, number one, one of the first things that you need to decide is, do you want to apply to a new program or do you want to apply to an established program? Now, most of my followers or subscribers already know that I was a part of an inaugural class at FMU, and I was a part of the first class, which, I mean, to me, I felt like I made history being a part of one of the first students to attend, go through the curriculum, go through clinicals, and actually graduate and pass the pants. I felt like this is important to think about because a lot of people just be like, I don't care if I go to a new or an established program, I just want to get into PA school, which is fine. But there are pros and cons to being a part of an inaugural class, which with me, I took the bad with the good, graduated and succeeded, and that was that. Some people have preferences, so I just urge you guys to keep that in mind. We'll also say some of the new programs that you see are on provisional status, and it's simply because they don't have the stats or the information they need to be accredited yet until you guys go through, because I mean, you guys will be the stats that they need to provide for that. So don't let the word provisional scare you. That should be just fine. New programs have a certain process that they have to go through, but new programs are just as exciting and new and, I don't know, elite as just any other program out there. So keep that in mind. If you have the part to be to be a part of an inaugural class, why not? Which brings me to point number two. What is the pants pass rate? Now, for a new program, you won't have this information, but for an established program, you will. And the pass rate, might you ask, is just an overview of how, or an overview of the percentage of students that pass the pants that have attended that PA program, which is highly important because you want to attend a program that can equip you with the information you need to be able to pass them boards. So that's the second thing you need to keep in mind. Point number three, can you afford it? Now, I know that sometimes this is a redundant question. I mean, unless you have a trust fund or your parents are just loaded, some people don't have the funding to pay for their whole PA school. So some people look for external sources for help, like the NHSC scholarship program. There's a lot of external sources that give scholarships for PA students. Your school or your financial aid department might even offer a scholarship for PA students, so make sure you check with your financial aid department and check online for those opportunities. Now, unfortunately, most people have to take out student loans, just like I did, to get through PA school. For me, off the bat, the federal government, I believe, gave $20,000 a year, and then the rest of my loans came from direct loans, which was, it was all through the government, but it was an extra loan that I had to apply for to be able to be approved. Of course, they ran my credit and everything like that so I can get the loan so I can go through school. So with that being said, a lot of people always ask, well, what if I have car trouble, or how am I going to pay my bills if my school is covered, but what about that? So that's where the direct loan came in for me because I had to take out a little bit extra because I needed a refund check to be able to, you know, pay my bills and be a part of an emergency fund in case something did happen to my car, because I didn't have the newest car in the world or the best car in the world. But she got me from point A to point B, so the job was done. But still, you never know what life is going to throw at you and what you're going to need money for. And for me, I didn't go outrageous. Like, I didn't take out big gooms and gobs of money, but I was sensible with it, and I just sat down, I discussed it with my loved ones, which meaning you should also discuss with your spouse, your mom, your dad, or your loved ones about what you should do and what they also think you should do about being able to afford PA school but also take care of the external things like car, gas, bills, etc. Point number four, do your prerequisites line up with what your top PA schools are requiring? For me, I personally avoided genetics. I did not like genetics in high school, and I surely didn't plan on taking it in undergrad, and I didn't. Each PA school is different in their requirements for applying to their program. Some PA schools that I looked at didn't require genetics, and those are the ones that I applied to. So I got away with that. That was helpful. For me, I stayed in constant communication from my very first semester in undergrad till I graduated with my advisor. I printed out the classes that I needed to take, and I made sure I fit them in as electives, or I substituted one class for the other, because my advisor was always helping me because I was so diligent and persistent in staying in contact with them and letting them know what I needed their help on. So that was a big thing. I didn't want to graduate from school just to go back to school to take extra classes. So we made it so I could take some of my science courses and some other courses that they were requiring as electives and still be on track for my degree. Also, I was an honors student in undergrad, so I had to be on track with that and my thesis and everything along with my PA requirements. So if I can give you any advice, if you're an undergrad and it's not too late, please try and see what your advisor can do for you to limit how long or how many times you have to enroll and go back to school just to take extra classes. I think that if you are honest and open and forthcoming and ahead of the game with everything that you need to get done, they'll be able to better assist you versus waiting to the last minute. There's nothing wrong with going back to school and doing post-bac or anything like that, but if you have the opportunity to do all of your prerequisites along with your required classes for your degree, then why not? Number five is highly crucial. Make sure that you're looking at when the application enrollment opens and when the deadline is, and if the school offers early decision. And if they do, you want to have all your ducks in a row so you can have all your stuff in for early decision. It looks really good to have all your stuff in the earliest that you can, but you don't want to do anything prematurely. So make sure you write your personal statement, and you have the writing center look over it. You have someone look over it from a medical standpoint as well, because you're going to need both feedbacks from each of these professionals. You're also going to need to make sure that when you're shadowing and you're doing your patient care hours, you are making buddy-buddy with your preceptors or your advisor or whoever, because they're going to be the ones that you ask for your letter, a recommendation, and you need to make sure that this person is reliable and that they're going to be able to get the link from CASPA, click on it, fill it out, and return it on time, so that even if you are applying for early decision, all of your stuff is still there. Like, this is highly important to make sure you have all your stuff together. I know a lot of people like to think that they have to wait to finish something before they do something else, and in some cases you do, but if you can be proactive, be as proactive as possible, because getting into PA school is highly competitive right now. So you want to make sure that you stand out, and if you can get your stuff in early, then that's one thing that you have on your side versus people who are going to apply later. So make sure you take heed of this, and you get all your stuff together. You need to get it together. One thing before I get to point number six, because I know I told you guys I was giving you five things, but yeah. So when you are applying to schools, make sure you have money saved up to apply. If you are applying for schools out of state, out of your reach, make sure you have money saved up to travel to these schools, to show your face at open houses. And if you get an interview, you need to have money for the plane ticket so you can fly out to all of these schools. So I would definitely recommend, before even applying to PA school, to open up and better have better luck and chance, give yourself the best chance possible at applying to the most schools possible. I would definitely recommend coming up with a savings plan or a budget. Don't be like me, because I didn't have a mentor, I didn't have any YouTube videos, I didn't have any blogs, I didn't have anybody to help me and tell me that. So as a result, I was only able to apply to two PA schools. I got rejected from one and approved with the other. So take that with a grain of salt. Again, applying to PA school right now is highly competitive because it's the hot commodity. It's where everybody wants to go, it's what everybody wants to do now. So make sure you have your money saved up to broaden your horizons so you can get the best possible chance of getting into PA school by broadening it. Don't try to just stay in state if you can help it. Apply to out of state as well. So last but not least, how many applicants do the school that you're applying to accept? And is the class diverse for students of color, for people of color? Did you know that we only make up 3% of the profession, which that is quickly changing because more of us are getting accepted into PA school? But make sure you attend open houses and you see other people that look like you. That way you're able to talk to them and you have somebody to relate. Other people might not think that this is a huge and important, you know, tip or tidbit, but I do think that it does make a difference to see someone that looks like you, someone that you can talk to and literally ask, do they like the program? How do they feel about the program? Open houses provides the opportunity to interact with current students. So sometimes that's the best thing possible, just to get another description of the program and feedback of the program other than what's on their website. You get to hear it from a person currently in it and someone that's already going through what you plan to go through. So make sure that you look at that as well. All right, guys, so those were my tips for things that you should keep in mind while researching and looking for your perfect PA program. Please make sure that you are in constant and close communication with your admissions office. And also, last but not least, please make sure you're doing your research on exactly what a PA is. The curriculum, use the website, use all the resources. There's a lot of forums online now. There's a lot of podcasts out there. One is called the PA Startup Podcast. That has been helpful. Make sure you're reaching out to other people. Social media is huge now. Everybody has in their bio either pre-PA or PAC or whatever. If you need to get on Instagram and shoot somebody an email just to ask a question, make sure you're doing that. I'm putting on my platform the opportunity to be able to help other people. So if you have a question for me, please leave it down below. My social media handles are in the description box. And as you heard last time in my previous video, I now have a website out, www.dreamsinspirelife.com, where you can also reach me and see all of my other social media handles on that website in one place. So guys, make sure that you take heed of the tips that I have given you today. And if you have any questions, again, leave them down below, and I'll see you guys again next time. Take care, guys.